Welcome, viewers. This is episode 63 of the ForensicWeek.com show, brought to you by Forensic IQ Incorporated. I'm your host, Tom Moriello, CEO of Forensic IQ and professor at the University of Maryland Department of Criminology and Criminal Justice in College Park, Maryland. Coming to you this evening from Revere, Massachusetts, where Revere Beach, which is right behind me, is the first public beach of the country. Beautiful area, and I'm up here with my family, and it's great weather, and I hope the weather's good where you are. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, a return guest of the ForensicWeek.com show from episode 31. For those of you who've been watching, you remember episode 31 with Daryl Durrell, a forensic accountant and co-author of the book Financial Forensics, Body of Knowledge. Tonight, we will be focusing on one of the forensic tools that he uses, a forensic tool for quantifying words called forensic lexicology, a term that is new to me, forensic lexicology, how to analyze words like numbers, which is part of linguistics, which studies words. How does analyzing words assist in an investigation? Want to find out? Then stay with us and learn about this fascinating forensic tool. Folks, you're listening to ForensicWeek.com, a talk show that features real forensic science by real forensic scientists, educators, law enforcement, and legal professionals who find, collect, and examine forensic evidence in the performance of their duties. Broadcast live on your desktop and mobile devices bi-weekly on Thursday evenings, 7 to 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, right here on our YouTube channel, www.forensicweek.com. We are a proud member of the Hangout10.com live TV webcast network, which is a series of shows like this one, brought to you live using Google+. Now, I got to tell you, I have a brand new mouse, and every time I touch it, it goes crazy. I want to introduce you to our producer for this evening's show. She is a forensic science graduate student from George Washington University in Washington, D.C., Laura Pachucci. Laura, tell our viewers how to ask questions and how to make comments.
All right. Thanks, Tom. Hi, everyone, and thank you for watching ForensicWeek.com. If you have any questions, comments, or ideas for future shows, you can email us at forensicweek@gmail.com. If you're watching this show live and you have a question for our guest, you can use the comment box below on YouTube or on Google+, and we can bring that question up on air. Also, if you like this show, you can click the subscribe button on YouTube, and you can watch all archive shows 24/7 online at forensicweek.com. You can also find us on Facebook by searching the ForensicWeek.com show. Thanks, and back to you, Tom.
Thank you, Laura. And I also want to introduce one of our newest members of the show. And she is responsible for the news special segment, In Real Life. She is a University of Maryland Department of Criminology and Criminal Justice PhD candidate, Whytnee Silva. Whytnee, welcome back. Glad to have you, and really appreciate the contributions to the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
All right. I wanted to mention to you, I mentioned last week, and this past week I spoke to a large group down at Fort Walton Beach, Florida, the NCMS Emerald Coast Chapter's 21st Annual Security Seminar. Great group of people. These are industrial security professionals. I gave an afternoon session on critical thinking. Great group of individuals. They're really, really enthusiastic and focused, and really engaged in the skills that we were talking about in reference to how to ensure they were asking the right questions and ensuring that we're getting valid and correct information. So to all my friends at Fort Walton Beach in the NCMS Emerald Coast chapter who told me that now that they heard about ForensicWeek.com that they were going to be listening tonight, thank you very much for your hospitality, and I look forward to being invited next year. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce tonight's guest and topic, forensic lexicology, a branch of linguistics concerned with the significance and application of words. Tonight, we are honored once again to have a national figure in the area of forensic accounting, Daryl Durrell. Daryl, thank you so much for being here.
I'm delighted to be here, Tom. I'm honored. You have a groundbreaking method of delivery, so I'm privileged to be associated with.
Well, we're honored also. For those that don't know this, Daryl is from Oregon, but right now he's in Richmond, Virginia, and speaking at a conference, and we'll learn a little bit more about that. But let me just tell you a little bit about Daryl. Daryl was the founding partner of Financial Forensics, a forensic accounting practice in Lake Wasego, Oregon. He's a national recognized speaker and author. Daryl has delivered more than over 120 training presentations on forensic accounting-related topics during the last 5 years. His presentations span 24 states, including 12 state CPA societies, Puerto Rico, and Canada. He has provided training to the FBI, United States Department of Justice, Securities and Exchange Commission, the American Bar Association, Bankruptcy Bar Association, to mention just a few. He co-authored for the United States Department of Justice training documents entitled Financial Forensics 1, Counterterrorism, Conventional Tools for Unconventional Warfare, and also Financial Forensics 2, Forensic Accounting, Counterterrorism, Tactical Weaponry. Both issues are provided via the public site, so Laura, if you haven't done it already, please put those out there so people who might be interested in that information. His book, Financial Forensic Body of Knowledge, co-authored with Greg Gadowski, was released in March 6th of 2012. The book is a unique, innovative, and definitive guide and technical reference book work for the financial forensics and forensic accounting professional, including nearly 300 forensic tools, techniques, methods, and methodologies that apply to virtually all civil, criminal, and dispute matters. The chapter on financial forensic tools, techniques, methods, and methodologies details forensic lexicology, and that is what we're going to focus on this evening. I sent an email to all our previous guests and said, listen, if you've got something that we haven't talked about in ForensicWeek.com that you think would be important for our viewers, please let me know. And Daryl sent me an email and said, look, I've got something about quantitating words and forensic lexicology, and I said, hey, that's great. I don't know what you're talking about, but I want to know. So that's what we're going to do tonight. But before we begin with lexicology, for those viewers who did not have the opportunity to view episode 31, and remember, viewers, you can always go back and watch it later. Daryl, tell us a little bit about forensic accounting in general in the types of cases that you're involved with.
Good, Tom. When the word the phrase comes up, forensic accounting, the problem is there isn't a well-known definition. And I think the public believes that accountants in general have investigative capabilities. However, they have more constructive capabilities in building financial statements. So the forensic aspect comes from the Latin word of the forum, which refers to being in trial. And forensic accountants are trained in investigation processes that overlay their accounting expertise. Now, given the framework and the experience of accountants, that lends themselves pretty well to all kinds of cases, whether civil, criminal, or even mere disputes. So if money's involved, the forensic accountant often makes sense to have one involved. If if money is not the issue, there are still skills that an accountant can bring to the table, things like we're talking about today, forensic lexicology. So a forensic accountant is defined by the definition, the art and science of investigating people and money. And when you think about those two pieces, art and science, mostly science if possible, but also people and money. And when we train accountants, they tend to recoil a bit about the people side, because accountants by definition don't have people training. But once you understand the people aspect, the money is easy to find.
You know, it's interesting, when I was going over the chapter of your book on lexicology, you referred to the term forensic operators. And that's the first time I've really heard forensic professionals referred to. Is there any particular reason why you chose the word operators?
Yes. I'm glad you picked up on that. That's good insight, Tom. Forensic accounting, or forensic account, as I sometimes call myself, is way too limiting. Forensic account, by definition, tends to focus on money. But the cases we get involved in, civil, criminal, or just mere dispute cases, often have very little to do with money. So the corollary, the word operator, ties into the military. When, for example, you've heard of a Delta Force or a SEAL team or Ranger Battalion, they're trained in mission-specific disciplines. And we do the same thing. We're trained in financial analysis and investigation, but often have to branch into other fields. Consequently, we're not just accountants by any stretch. We're operators to the extent that we have an expertise that we, over which we overlay other skills and talents.
Another assumption that people make with accountants is that you're always just looking at the numbers. And forensic lexicology is beyond the numbers. So this is a perfect time to, let's introduce forensic lexicology as a tool. How do you use that in the performance of your cases, and how could investigators use that beyond, you know, again, we don't want, again, be limited and think that this lexicology has to do with just accounting. It can be utilized anytime there's documents. And nowadays, there's documents are involved in any crime. So tell us a little bit. Let's get into the meat of lexicology, so our viewers truly know what it is, how it can be used, and why it's important for them.
Sure. Lexicology, just by its construct, tells you that it involves the study of words. The forensic lexicology aspect of it suggests that it's investigative study of words. Now, the reason that applies, as I said before, that the art and science of investigating people and money, people being more important, people use words every day. They write them, they speak them, they type them, and those words that they use yield what we refer to as a linguistic fit fingerprint, or a textual fingerprint. And what I mean by that is the words you're using, Tom, and if you've used in these episodes, you tend to use similar words, very similar sentence structures, same number of words per sentence, same types of syntax, perhaps slang and acronyms and so forth. And so you literally identify yourself by a word pattern. Now, you do the same thing when you write, say, reports. Same number of sentences per paragraph, same size of words and so forth. So each person, you and I and Whytnee and Laura, have a linguistic and a textual fingerprint that can help identify us. Now, that becomes important for things like when you're trying to compare documents. We were asked one case by an attorney to investigate three documents that were submitted by the opposing expert. And the question was, did the opposing expert write all three of these documents? Now, he said he did, but we analyzed those three documents using just very simple tools we'll talk about today and determined that he wrote two of them, but one of them had a rather heavy influence by an outsider, possibly the attorney he was working with.
Were you able to testify to that?
We didn't have to. The attorney used it in deposition, and got to the heart of where the differences were. It gave him a tool then to drill down more deeply into the opinions he had formed.
Okay, I really want to talk about the legal aspects in, you know, science versus art, but I think it's too early to do that because I really want you to continue to really, you know, explain to our viewers exactly what you're looking at when you talk about that, when you the words and phrases and how do you find them and how do you identify similarities and differences, because that's what forensic science is all about, similarities and differences.
It is, yes. I'll give you a quick example. We assisted a Canadian federal securities agency about 2 years ago in analyzing mostly emails but also written correspondence from their registrants. So they have an agency not unlike the Securities and Exchange Commission in the U.S., where quarterly the registrants have to file financial statements with the agency, and annually also, similar to a 10K and a 10Q, 10Q quarterly and 10K annually. They began to get concerned that when the documents were submitted, the compliance investigators would send emails and other correspondence to the CEO, CFO, and others, and asking questions to clarify certain aspects of the financials. The concern came about when the emails were coming back and they had some suspicion that either a different party wrote it or multiple parties wrote it and didn't address the question. So we were asked to analyze or train them how to analyze email content to determine whether or not the person specifically addressed did indeed respond to the agency. Now, a quick example of that. It's very basic, but it's fundamental to forensic lexicology. For example, there's a book we'll look at later in the material written by Dr. James Pennebaker, and he has compelling evidence that men and women use words very differently. Now, for example, if I referred to the table I'm sitting near here as a table as a male, I would tend to say that's a table. A female might intend to use what are called descriptor words, such as, well, that's a heavy table or an expensive table, a weak table, that sort of thing. So with basic understanding of gender, for example, you can build on that, and there's software from a company in Australia that you can embed in a keyboard, and they can point to what's called factor analysis and identify the sex of the person, the age, the level of education, the ethnicity, prior experience, just based upon word content.
You know, I'm smiling here. I don't know if anybody's wondering why I'm smiling. While you're talking, I'm just thinking of my lovely wife. You know, if I wanted to offer you a cup of coffee, I would say, hey, would you like a cup of coffee? My wife would say, would you like a nice hot cup of coffee?
Yes.
Of course it's going to be hot. It's not going to be, you're going to give him a cold cup of coffee, you know.
Right.
But she adds a number of adjectives that I just generally don't do. You know?
Exactly.
That's cool. Okay. All right.
Yeah.
I'm looking at time. Time goes so quickly here. It's already 20 past the hour. So would you like to go, I know you have some slides that will help our audience. Would you like to get, are we at that point where you would like to begin those?
Let's do a couple of those, yes.
Okay.
So Laura, if you don't mind bringing those up. And I understand I can just highlight them and we'll, others can come back and read it in more detail if they like.
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay, the slide I see says Note 16 to Financial Statements. Now, this and the following slide, if you don't mind going to that one, Laura, this is a reproduction of what's known as Note 16 in Enron's financial statements. And the gentleman who, the stock analyst, who really broke the illegitimacy of Enron, credits his analysis to this note. Now, one reason is that you'll note this, you'll see this note is almost 900 words in the financials, which by itself is at least worthy of investigation. Why is it so long? But if we had a couple of hours, we could parse and drill down into the word content to demonstrate why he made his conclusion about Enron based on the content. Now, that's a financial application. Next slide, if you would, Laura.
Laura, I can't see the... Can everybody see... Oh, there it goes. There it goes.
Yeah, okay. I think it's coming up now.
There we go.
Another example of that is something called statement analysis. And law enforcement, military, have been using this for years, where they'll take a suspect and they'll videotape and analyze what he or she is saying. And I'll give you a quick example. This has to do with veracity. The first category there in statement analysis refers to pronoun usage. The attorney asks this expert in deposition, when did you receive your CPA certificate? The expert answered, I received my CPA certificate in January 1991. Next, the attorney asked, when did you first begin your forensic training? The expert answered, began my forensic training about 5 years ago. Now, I'll throw it back to Laura and Whytnee and you, Tom. Compare and contrast those two expert answers. Are they similar? Are they different?
Well, he stopped using the pronoun.
Yeah, and what does that tell you?
Well, I'm not sure. Is it telling me that a different person fed him that information?
Well, you're on the right track, because the second answer, began my forensic training, is very different than the first answer that said, I received. So the second answer is a disassociated pronoun, meaning he's not taking ownership in that comment. The first one, very specific, I began my training, or I received my certificate. The second one, began my training about. The second aspect of that is the first sentence was very specific, January 1991. The second answer was about 5 years ago. So two critical measures in veracity are what are called ownership and specificity. And that answer lacked both of them. And we looked, and of course his training, he had no forensic training, so he was lying. But lack of specificity and lack of ownership are indicators of deceit.
That's interesting. We had Dorothy Sims, who was the defense attorney in the Casey Anthony case, who is a specialist, an attorney on testimony of scientists that are testifying again about what she refers to as junk science, are finding out that people don't have the training or the background that they allege. And so I'm wondering whether she uses this technique to, in her study. That'd be interesting to ask her.
Could well be. Some people do it naturally. It's a formalized field in law enforcement and the military. It's called statement analysis. And you can just search it on Google and you'll find more of the detail. But very intuitive, very easy to use, and widely applied.
Now, is there software that picks this stuff up?
No, not for statement analysis that I'm aware of. There's okay. Software for other aspects, but not this one. Okay. And maybe go to the next slide, Laura, if you don't mind. Now, this is a case we worked on. This is an actual deposition transcript. And a woman was driving her two children, was hit by a U.S. Postal Service truck, and was claimed to be injured. So she and her husband sued the federal government for several million dollars plus two 24-hour caregivers for the rest of her life. So the question was she injured, and how much should she be paid if indeed she was injured? So we have two slides here. The first one is mixed testimony, and the husband was being deposed to determine the extent of the wife's injuries. Now, I'll read aloud the first answer from the husband. I've been to almost every doctor appointment with her because she doesn't like to go by herself. Now, Whytnee or Laura or Tom, do you believe that statement?
No.
Yeah, you're exactly right. That's true, Whytnee. Now, part of the reason that's true is that, like we said before, specificity. He said, I've been. Now, almost, or ownership, I'm sorry, almost says specificity, but he didn't know the number of appointments. And the third criteria is it's a very short response. So ownership, general specificity, and short response, and we followed up and his statement was true. Now, if you go to the next slide, if you would, Laura, The first slides we looked at were before lunch. The second slide has deposition responses from the husband after lunch. Now, I'll read that first sentence, first answer. She doesn't tolerate medicine very well at all. So she can, I mean, like a quarter of a tablet will have an effect on her. And so, particularly because she has so many things to do, obligations at home and stuff with the kids, because, you know, fortunately, I'm able to work and she can stay home and take care of the kids and their needs. Now, Tom, Laura, Whytnee, was he telling the truth there or not?
I don't know the relevancy of some of those words.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah, he was lying. What he was trying to do, too, you see the difference in the first slide and the second slide. The second slide, he's trying to remember what his attorney told him, get on record. So before lunch, he was very terse. After lunch, he gets more and more contrived, as you can see by the size of the sentences.
Interesting.
Next slide, if you would, Laura. There are some slides in here, too, about bias, meaning I've seen a lot of deposition transcripts where someone will say, you know, I went to the store, you know. And some people literally have that preconceived bias about what constitutes a lie. But you have to practice, and if you look at different some of the internet sites I've shown you, you can find veracity of word content. And if you'd go back to that Harvard slide for a second, Laura. Yeah, that one. There are many studies out there, but Harvard's concluded a media bias towards what they call Democrats. Now, that's probably no surprise to anybody that media is biased, you know, to one extent or the other. But that gives you the ability to determine what is indeed objective and what is indeed independent if you're able to look at written and spoken words as nothing more than data. That's where the lexicology comes in.
Very good. Very good. Please, can
okay.
Again, I'm looking. The time is just going really fast, so yes. I'm going to stop there for 1 second. I'm going to bring Whytnee up in the In Real Life segment, and when we come back, I want to focus on two things. One, okay, the tools. What can investigators use? You know, I want to talk a little bit about this flesh reading ease and flesh Kennard grade level in readability statistics that actually sits in Word, in Microsoft Word, which I was surprised of, and yes. That other software, My Word Count, as tools to use, if you don't mind, in the interest of time.
Absolutely.
Okay, fantastic. And give you a little break. Whytnee, tell us, in real life, what do we have this week?
Okay, so tonight's In Real Life segment is going to explore the murder of JonBenet Ramsey. And she was found dead in her home in Boulder, Colorado on Christmas Day, 1996. And since I was so young when that happened, I'm going to turn to Tom to talk about the evidence that was released to the media.
Well, I mean, there was a lot of evidence. First of all, this is a major faux pas right from the beginning. When the parents called the police and said, we think our child is, well, we know our child is missing, the police respond. And because the parents said their child was missing, that established a crime. They should have immediately established a crime scene. They should have, you know, the last time she was seen was in the house. But they didn't do that. They went inside. They sat around the kitchen. They invited the neighbors in. And the police said to the father and the neighbors, why don't you look around the house to see if something's out of place? And it was at that point in time that the father and a neighbor found the JonBenet's body in the basement, which was a very large house. So at some point in time, the mother and father became suspect. They wanted them to take a polygraph. They first refused, being a polygraph examiner myself. Then they said, okay, we're willing to take a polygraph, but we have to hire our own polygraph examiner. It's like, you know, we're gonna get our own fox to guard the hen house, you know, that kind of thing. But one of the most significant things that I think is good this evening, because we have Daryl with us this evening, is a ransom note. Very interesting that the alleged suspects left a ransom note asking, saying that they had the daughter and that they wanted $118,000 to get her back. And again, now we know they didn't have the daughter because the daughter was dead. But this note was in question, and they believe that possibly somebody in the ransom, Ramsey family may have written the note, because, interesting enough, the note was written on a pad of paper, and when they found the pad that was used, they could tell that this letter was written in the house during the time in question. Now, who's going to, take a child away and hold them for ransom and not have the note ahead of time? And the other thing was they asked for $118,000, not $100,000, not $200,000, not $250,000, some round number. No, $118,000. And it just so happens that Mr. Ramsey had received a $118,000 Christmas bonus that very week. So anyways, a question document examiner examined the ransom note. They got sample writings from the husband, the wife's name being Patsy, and the son, I believe, and they were able to eliminate the father, or the husband in this case, and the son, but they never were able to eliminate Patsy Ramsey as the author of this letter. And since then, she's passed away. And Laura's got that up on the screen right now. And on the right-hand side, that's the ransom note. And the left-hand side is a sample of Patsy's right-hand writing. Now, how they do that is they dictate the writing, and they do not give the person any specific direction. The only direction they would give her is that to print it versus cursive writing, because as you can see, it's a printed note, and she did that. And besides the fact, the question document examiner focuses on the letter formation. For example, we all learned how to write and print around the second, third grade, and based on our own habits and limitations, we develop our own style of creating the letters. Right? Now, that's purely the letters, not the words, but the letters. And whether we slant them, how much pressure we put down on the paper, how we hold the paper, whether we're right-handed or left-handed, all those things affect what we see when we're looking at the writing. Now, today we're talking about forensic lexicology, and Daryl, I know I said I was going to give you a rest, but the rest is over. What is your opinion, because I don't know of any lexicologist who may have looked at this during the time in question, because most people know that they've never determined who killed JonBenet Ramsey. There was a big problem with the prosecution and the police not cooperating with each other, and it was just a mess. But what do you think about these documents, and whether a lexicology analysis might help?
If you might put that up on the screen, Laura, I can point to some things on it. And while Laura's putting that up, I've only had a short time to look at this. I've never seen the note before earlier today, but a couple of things strike me immediately. And bear in mind, I'm not a graphologist or a handwriting analyst at all. I'm just concerned with the word content. But first of all, as you said, it's paper from inside the house. So if someone goes in the home, does indeed kidnap JonBenet, and writes this note, it's very long. Many ransom notes, or most perhaps, are very short, very terse, very to the point. Secondly, it's almost no cursive inside, meaning it would take a great deal of time to write this note. So someone who entered the home, kidnapped a child, and then now found some paper and is under stress to write the note would do cursive instead of handwriting. non-cursive because of the time required. Additionally, when you look at the content, some of these words are really interesting, where later on she said, take a brown paper bag, brown being a descriptor, also an attaché that's large enough, other characteristics. It, as I said earlier, after looking at it without my tools available, I would conclude that a woman wrote the note, not because of the handwriting, but because of the word content and the word descriptors that were being used. So that's a quick summary.
By the way, what I did mention is that looking at the pressure in the pad of paper, they started writing it and then didn't like it and then ripped the page and started again. So they were they wrote more than one. They only found one letter, but they could tell that they started writing it, didn't like what they said, so they went back and started over again.
Now, that wasn't where that'd be a very relaxed kidnapper.
Can you believe it? Can you believe it?
No, I can't. No.
But, you know, it would be very interesting to see some of Patsy Ramsey's previous writings. Because, correct me if I'm wrong, to do the proper analysis with lexicology, you would have to see previous writings of Patsy Ramsey, correct?
That'd be preferred, Tom. You can look at this individual writing and determine sex, probably age, levels of education, and so forth. But determine that may fit her, those characteristics, but to determine that, in fact, she wrote it, prior writings of any kind would be helpful. That could be email, correspondence, even spoken words that have been transcribed.
It's interesting, the ransom note, that the misspelled words, they look like they, you know, they were very specifically done intentionally, like possession,
yes.
The first, you know, and a few other words like that. And in the ransom note, 118,000 are in numbers, and then she writes it, when she gives the sample, she writes them out. Now, who writes out number? Now, okay, as an accountant, how often do you see somebody writing that out? Unless the only time I ever write that out is when I'm writing out a check, and I don't do that very often.
No, you're exactly right, Tom. I had the same reaction, thinking that if indeed she writes a lot of checks, that could be a natural habit, but that's no one's going to take the time to do so.
Yeah. Well, I believe she did it, but again, I'm not inconclusive, but it looks like that, and unfortunately, the poor woman died of cancer, and I don't know what the father's doing nowadays, who I believe is probably responsible for this whole thing, and I think the wife knew it. That's my personal opinion, but hey, nobody's been asking for my personal opinion. Whytnee, did you have any other questions about that for myself or Daryl?
No, I think you guys covered it all. Great job.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Let's get back with you, Daryl. I was reading your chapter, and I start learning about readability statistics, that if I go into a certain part of Microsoft Word, I can have them do a readability statistics. And I said, what is that? Tell us what that is.
Good. Virtually everyone I speak to is surprised that Word, Microsoft Word, has forensic tools in it. But Laura, if you wouldn't mind bringing up the slide that has the title called Style Testing Example, we can look at that. Now, Word has it embedded, presumably, is my opinion of it, Tom, for things like grammar, spell check, and so forth. And so it's embedded, and anyone who writes a Word document, let's see, style testing example. Anyone who writes a Word document and does a review, one more right there. Go one more down if you don't mind. Down. There you go. Perfect. Good. Now, if you write a document in Word and you decide to do a spell check and a grammar check, which I'm sure all of us do every time, this dialog box surfaces. Now, it'll tell you, I'll read some of the content. I told you before there were three documents we were asked to determine consistency of writer, consistency of authorship, and this is the output we had. So the on the left, where it says number one there, readability statistic, that dialog box comes up after you complete a spell check in Word. Now, it has three categories to it. First category has what they call counts, and it counts the numbers of words, characters, paragraphs, and sentences in your respective document. Then the second category in the middle is averages, and it measures sentences per paragraph, words per sentence, and characters per word. So with the averages and the counts, you're able to start to get some comparative analysis among the three documents using only Microsoft Word as the tool. And you'll notice on the averages, the sentences per paragraph on document one were 2.1. Sentences per paragraph on document two were 2.0, very similar. Document three, however, had almost double that, of 3.6 sentences per paragraph. Now, when I said earlier, every one of us on this video and listening to it has a linguistic fingerprint or a textual fingerprint. And so if you looked at all the authors of all the documents from author three, the sentences per paragraph would tend to run at about 3.6, 4, 3.8. Then finally, in the bottom, what are called readability statistics. And a word has three categories, passive sentences, Flesch reading ease scale, and Flesch Kincaid grain level scale. Now, the reason for that, passivity, those are passive sentences, and you want to avoid that in writing, and that's a real problem of mine. I'm always doing passive sentences, so I use this analysis to get rid of them. But the Flesch reading ease scale goes from about 0 to about 100. Now, if you're at about 100 on that scale, that's a very simple and easy-to-read document. If you're down in these ranges of 31.5, 27.7, 40.9, 30 is very complex. That's where you're down to probably the Wall Street Journal article level or even lower. And when you compare documents 1 and 2 again, you see that the Flesch reading ease scale on document 1 is 31.5, on document 2 is 27.7. Not too far off. However, 3 is again outlier, 40.9 for the Flesch scale. Then finally, the Flesch Kincaid grade level scale. And that says for document 1, 13.4. That roughly translates saying that that individual graduated from high school and had 1.4 years of post-secondary education. The middle individual had about 14 scale there, and the other one 11.8. Now, those are comparative measures, and those techniques from Flesch have been around almost 80 years. It was first developed by the Navy to identify candidates who could be officer material. So to have this combination of analytical output within Word is a forensic word that we use to determine that document 3 was written by somebody else. Now, I will say, Tom, also two things. Notice the word count at the very top is very different. One has as low as 5,000 some odd words, the other one's almost 12,000. And the interesting thing about that is it doesn't matter very much about the word size. Secondly, you can also take this within a document. Many times we see opposing expert reports, and we'll be reading along, and on page 5, something will jump out at us, like, where did that come from? And that's probably input from someone else identifying someone who wasn't the author. So the style testing can be done on a document as a whole, comparatively, or even within a document. And it's free since you already have it in Microsoft Word.
Okay, now you talk about My Word Count, which is a software, and also you had mentioned about signatures, style metrics. What are these software packages and these tools that investigators might want to use, can easily use, and what will they do for them?
Yes, if you go to the next slide, Laura, I think that should be Word Count. That one, yeah. Yeah, it's a piece of software, $14.95. I've spoken to the guy who developed it. He doesn't want to raise the price.
Well, thank you. And don't raise it until I get it by the weekend. Okay?
Exactly. I'll let him know. Now, my word count was also developed for authors and writers, just like the readability statistics are within Microsoft Word. The idea here is to use my word count to improve your writing. So if I were, say, writing a novel or a report, I would use my word count to analyze it. Now, you'll see about one-third of the way down there are what appear to be tabs. One tab is words, the next one's phrases, the next one's sentence start, and so on and so forth. So those categories, once you take your document, you can take a PDF, convert it to Word, and import it immediately. Very, very facile tool. And you see that we have word counts identified, and those words are four characters or longer that we've identified as the criteria. Now, this document happens to be a public sector document from one William Jefferson Clinton regarding one Monica Lewinsky. So we took the public document, loaded it into word count, and you can see the most heavily used word is the word the, and that was used 741 times. Also, you can analyze within comparison to other words and their extent of usage or where they fall in comparison to the word. Can you put that up again, Laura? It disappeared for some reason. Go down one more slide, if you would. Yes. Now, suppose you wanted to identify a certain word. My word count will identify on the left where it occurred within the context of the text, and on the right, the frequency of occurrence within this entire deposition. So my word count will analyze words, phrases, sentence starts, most obvious words, word characters, word strings, and others. So it's a fabulous tool for attorneys who want to take a deposition transcript and analyze discrepancies or inconsistencies or avoidance, for that matter. Now, if you could go to the go down about five or six more slides, Laura. While she's doing that, keep going. Right there. Go back to the bar graph, if you would. For example, word frequency. Let's say I'm being deposed. I might average 10 words per sentence in a response in my deposition. However, if they spot sentences that are, say, 35 words for me, that suggests that I'm either trying to get something on record that they haven't asked me or vice versa. I'm trying to be deceitful. So this tells you the typical sentence length, word length, and so forth that gives you just about every diagnostic you would want within a single written document.
Where do we go to get the explanations of the analysis? In other words, you say, okay, if we have X amount of words here, this means this, this means they're lying, this is deceptive. Where do you learn about this, and is this, how valid is this information?
Well, I'll answer it this way. You said, where do you learn about it? The only place I'm aware of that is fully collected is our book, unfortunately. But I'd encourage anybody who's interested, start with Microsoft Word and do the readability statistics and just look up what Flesch Reading Ease Scale and Flesch Kincaid Grade Level Scale means. Secondly, buy the Word Count, My Word Count software for $14.95 and start testing and analyzing. Now, third, there's a book by Dr. James Pennebaker, P-E-N-N-E-B-A-K-E-R, and he has a website. It's called The Secret Life of Pronouns. The Secret Life of Pronouns. Now, if you're traveling and you don't want to be bothered by anybody, I can guarantee you, if they see you reading this book, they won't talk to you.
I believe that.
But his book, he's a linguist, and his book has a far broader composition than this investigative focus. However, he has chapter 7, I believe, is an entire chapter on what he calls fraud words. And it's pretty impressive, pretty compelling. So just for that chapter alone, it's worth buying the book. The other last thing I'd mention is if you'd go down a couple of more slides, Laura. Yes, that one, stylometry. That's the one that you can download for free. Type in signature and stylometry. Now, stylometry is another branch of the forensic lexicology. It falls within forensic lexicology. But scroll down one more slide, Laura. And this is an example. It's similar to my word count, but my word analyzes one document at a time, whereas signature can analyze multiple documents. Now, this is another case where we had two documents. Attorneys believe one might have been heavily influenced by another party. And using signature, again, we can analyze, as you see at the bottom, word length, sentence length, paragraph, etc., but on a comparative basis. So scroll down one, Laura. Okay, one more. And did that one. That's it. Good. Now, for example, this has compared every word of the alphabet. You can also do other punctuation marks if you want. But the comparative use, you can see the letters are almost identical within the two documents. You see very little difference there. And scroll down one more. One more. Yeah, and one more. I'm sorry, Laura. This should be a... Yes, okay. What another very powerful capability it has, you see on the left-hand side, you can prepare a word list that you want to compare within the two documents. And you see great divergence, the blue versus the green line, compared to the almost identical convergence of the letter count. So one document had words in it like accounting, fiscal, transaction, accrual. Another document had words like jurisdiction, sanction, precedent, statute. And it became very clear that the two documents had at least two different authors within them. And this tool is free, so you know, no risk to it.
Very interesting. Very, very interesting.
But that leads to your question, though, Tom. You said how persuasive or reliable is it? It's so intuitive once you start walking through this. You pay attention to everything you see in here, in the newspaper, in radio. I use it often to illustrate whether politicians are telling the truth or not. And it's all based upon this linguistic and textual fingerprint.
Has, to your knowledge, has anybody been able to testify as an expert to this analysis where it met a Fry or Daubert standard?
The Fry and Daubert standard, I'm confident it would, just because it's from the field of linguistics and you know, extensive amount of writing. I'm not aware of anyone testifying to it regarding some of the things you've saw here, because what happens is this information surfaces, it's often used in things like motion for summary judgment. For example, we had a case assisted the defendant on a damages matter and compared the use of the word part, P-A-R-T, in the plaintiff's original pleading with respect to his attorney's filings. Complaint, motion for summary judgment, and so forth. And it turned out that the word part by itself means nothing, but in the context it was significant, was used very heavily in the first from the plaintiff, but had been almost downgraded to non-existent with the attorney, by the attorney's writings, using synonyms such as segment, portion, percentage, etc. And a motion for summary judgment was effective that precluded plaintiff's counsel from using those terms since it wasn't specifically the word part.
very good. Well, I appreciate that you've been able to present a tool that can be used for investigators, no matter what the crime is. In the interest of time, like I always do at the end, I always want my guests to tell our listeners a little bit about, okay, how did you get to where you are in 60 seconds? How did you start? And is there a special major? If somebody's interested in maybe they're an accountant already, or they're majoring in accountant, but they're interested in the forensics aspect, how do they get it? How do they start there? How do they get there?
Great question. Don't follow the path I followed. It's like a rabbit trail, and because there wasn't anything that said here are the steps to go through. Someone who wants to be involved today, do this. First, get an accounting degree. With that accounting degree, do a lot of study on people. That could be psychology, sociology, anthropology, doesn't matter. Second, go to work for the biggest accounting firm you can find to get your certificate. Third, go into law enforcement, and that'll probably be federal, FBI, NSA, CIA, Secret Service, and so forth. And school yourself in the ability to analyze use skills that you haven't picked up in your curriculum. Also, for those who are already accountants and don't have the luxury of that possibility, contact your local law enforcement offices, federal, state, and local. We work with a lot of law enforcement. We've got the highest regard for them. And when you contact them, they'll rebuff you because they don't know who you are. They're suspicious by nature. But keep after it. Once you gain their trust, do work for free in anything, and that starts the fuse burning. Now, I will say there's one university I'm aware of in the U.S. that has an undergraduate degree in forensic accounting, and that's Carlow University, C-A-R-L-O-W University in Pennsylvania. I think it's near Pittsburgh. Virtually every other curriculum I've seen, particularly in the graduate so-called forensic program, is little more than a graduate accounting degree with a fraud course thrown in. So sadly, there isn't a well-described curriculum that I'm aware of, Tom.
Well, Darrell, listen, you've been very, very helpful and great information for our listeners. Before I say goodbye to you, there's just a couple of things going on in the forensic community I wanted to let our listeners know. The feds aim to fund forensic science finally. The Department of Commerce, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, NIST, is preparing to give $20 million to fund a new forensic science research center, which will work on establishing a firm scientific foundation for key methods in sciences. Plain and simple, what this means is because of the Mayfield case and because we realize that many of the forensic fields do not have standards, fingerprints. We used to think that fingerprints had a specific number of points of identification to make identification. There is none. What is the standard? What research has been done to establish it? Firearms identification. How many striation marks do you need to connect to be able to say that they two bullets were fired from the same gun? So there is $20 million that is getting ready to be handed out. The competition is open to any university or nonprofit organization that wants to take part. Applications are due by December 11th. So those of you who are listening who fall into that category in a university or nonprofit organization who wants to get involved in this kind of research to help the forensic community to survive in the future, because that's important. The National Academy of Sciences and Congress have said that the forensic science community has to wake up and realize that they can't just tell people what their opinion is and let it get accepted anymore. They gotta show the statistics that bears that up. So that's an important factor. Another one, the University of Florida has a graduate certificate program in forensic sciences. It's a 15-credit program, all online. So some of you professionals who want to continue and get a graduate certificate, the University of Florida has four four areas of concentration: forensic death investigation, forensic DNA and serology, forensic toxicology, and forensic drug chemistry. So that's a great program, University of Florida down in Gainesville. But again, it's online, so you can be anywhere you like, just like ForensicWeek.com. My good friend Darrell is sitting in a hotel in Richmond, Virginia. I'm sitting in my mother's condo in Revere, Massachusetts. Whytnee Silva is somewhere in Maryland. Where are you, Whytnee? You got to turn your...
I'm sorry. I'm actually home in D.C.
D.C., okay. And then, Laura, you're in Montgomery County. So I'll tell you, the power of the Internet is wonderful. I want to thank our guest, Darrell Durrell. I know you're a busy guy. You took time. And I know when you're out on travel and you know, speaking at conferences, you got other things to be concerned with. Not only did he take the time, but he also didn't have a computer, and he had to go and, I understand, rent a computer and a webcam. I just appreciate it very much, and I know my listeners do.
Happy to do it. I'm honored to be involved.
Okay. Thank you very much. And next show is October 2nd. That will be... on anti-bullying. You all remember Dr. Kwanda Stevenson from Athens University in Georgia. October is anti-bullying month. She's going to be with us again to speak further on the subject. She's going to have some police officers who are involved in conducting those investigations. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Laura, thank you for your expertise. Whytnee and Darrell, take care. Thank you.
Good evening to all.